There's a good chance that most of what we think we know about Moses was taught to us by Charlton Heston. We watch your Ten Commandments and we see it unfolded in cinemascope and we take it as gospel. You notice as we read the scripture together this morning, how we very quickly jump from the beginning of his birth to virtually midlife, and there's no details in there at all. Suddenly he's a grown man. Suddenly he's making decisions. It's really a fascinating story, something that, again, it's very difficult for us to comprehend, the culture, the oppression. Pharaoh had just recently become nervous about the Hebrews. They'd been enslaved for a couple of hundred years, and they had a propensity to multiply, having children and children and children. And as it turns out, there comes a point in time when the slave owner is worried that there are too many slaves to manage, to control, so that the owners can be safe. And so Pharaoh offered a solution that all the male children born to Hebrew women would be killed. Most of us have heard that story, probably since we were very young. And again, it's one of those horrific moments in Scripture that maybe we've heard so many times, we've lost touch with how horrific it is. All your children, your babes, will be taken from your arms and killed. That's the character of Egyptian slavery in that day. And so what's a mother to do? Just as Moses' mother, I've got a healthy young boy here. I'm going to do anything I can. I'm going to hide the baby for 3 months so he's not found, not taken away from me, not killed. And when he's just too big and too noisy to hide any longer, I'm going to make a decision. And what a decision it was. To keep the child at home was a death sentence for the baby. You have to understand that for the rest of the passage to make any sense at all. She didn't have a real option to keep the baby at home. We can't send it off to Aunt Martha. We can't do like English people did during the buzz bombs of the 1940s and send it to a cousin out in the country away from London. There's no place to send the children. A decision, God help, we never have to make. What do I do? She could have just resolved to accept fate. But she says, I'm going to take one chance. The only chance I think I have, I'm going to put the baby on the water and trust God for the rest. And so she does. Again, imagine that moment when she gave that little push and let go of her child's life and future, sending Miriam out there to wait in the high weeds to just kind of see what happens. A decision to trust God with my child's life. Along comes Pharaoh's daughter, the most privileged of the privileged. And if she has the same character as her family, heartless lack of compassion for the Hebrew slaves, we're going to discover that pretty quickly. She is brought to an awareness, oh look, there's a baby out there. She sends her slave out there. What's she going to do? Oh, it's a Hebrew child, take him to the guards, let them dispose of it the way Pharaoh has ordered. I'm loyal to my family dynasty. Or she makes a different decision, the one that we read. Why don't we save the child? Why don't we just take care of it? Miriam shows up with the offer, hey, I can find a Hebrew woman to nurse the child until he's old enough to be on his own. Well, that's a good idea. Miriam takes him back to his own mother to be nursed, to be raised. A decision. Sure, we'll give this child a chance. A decision, not only one that she did not have to make, but one that she was actually violating Pharaoh's order as she made it, with the possibility of forfeiting her own life. Again, something that we can seldom comprehend in our culture and our time, to say, okay, maybe if I ignore the authorities, I might get a speeding ticket, or I might be arrested, or I might be ridiculed, but there's very little likelihood that if I break a minor law that someone's going to execute me. But that was her reality. In the face of her life and death, she made the decision to give the child a chance. He grows up. He grows up fast, or later on we'll discover that, you know, scripture suggesting that Moses would indeed spend the first 40 years of his life as the privileged member of Pharaoh's household. Scripture suggested that Moses' life was broken very distinctly into 40 years of privilege, 40 years of peacefulness, and 40 years with the Hebrews, mostly in the wilderness. He's approaching 40 years old. He apparently, from what we read in Scripture, has come to understand that he is Hebrew. Someone has spilled the beans. Because when he sees the Egyptian beating the Hebrew, he's incensed. And he makes a decision. I'm going to protect the life of that brother of mine being beaten. And he kills the Egyptian. And while we can't say that we condone it or that God approved of the killing by any stretch, in reality it was either a kill or be killed or watch someone be killed situation, and he made his decision, thinking, of course, that no one saw him. He looked to his left and to his right and behind him, and no one was there, as if you can ever truly do anything in secret. He made a decision for the sake of another Hebrew. It's the very next day. At least he didn't have to wait and worry for a long time. The very next day he discovers that he was seen. The word gets out to Pharaoh very quickly. And Moses, I guess the one advantage of knowing that there would be no mercy from Pharaoh, is that you don't have to decide whether to cut and run or stay and face the music. It's very clear, I got to get out of here. And so he runs. He makes a decision. I'm not going to face this kind of consequence for my choice. I'm getting out, and he runs. Escapes across the wilderness, heads into the land of Midian, where we leave him, sitting on the edge of a well. Sitting there, resting comfortably with water right at his hand, probably what he would like to do the rest of his life. I've had enough drama. I've seen enough violence. I've lived in this environment of hate long enough. It's kind of nice just out here in the pasture by the well, sitting and breathing. Very many of us who haven't had it nearly as difficult as Moses has had it in those previous weeks still enjoy sitting by the well, taking a deep breath and avoiding as much responsibility as we can. He's sitting there waiting for what happens next. There's a not only a want that we are talking about Moses from Charlton Heston, but there's a lot about Moses that we just plain don't know. And we filled in the gaps with speculation over the centuries and pretended that we know what we don't know. We aren't even entirely sure about the origin of his name. We're told, as we read this morning, that his stepmother called him Moses because it sounded like the Egyptian word for being drawn out of water. Because we drew him out of the water, so he's named accordingly. But Moses also is very similar to a Hebrew name, Hebrew words that would be interpreted roughly as he saved them from the water. He was drawn out of the Nile to save his own life. He would later save his people from the waters of the Red Sea, we're told. An Egyptian name, a Hebrew name, a life of great privilege, or a life of servitude and humility. And as it would seem, the great question that would be facing him his entire life would be, who am I? Am I Moses the Egyptian or Moses the Hebrew? Am I going to side with the most privileged of the privileged? Or am I going to side with the most oppressed of the oppressed? As he's sitting there on the well, he's already made some decision. At least, I'm not going to stand here while the privilege continues to destroy. I'm going to run away so I don't have to see it. Right? He's not doing a thing to help anybody off in this wilderness in Midian, off sitting on this wall. He's not doing, lifting a finger to help anybody. He's just helping himself to what seems to be a more peaceful life, right? And it's as if we just quit reading the newspaper and the magazines and turn off the television and ignore what's happening in the rest of the world. Our life seems a whole lot more peaceful. What flood in Texas? I don't have to sit and worry and wonder and have compassion and care for those people. I don't know what you're talking about. What bombing in Spain? What devastation in Africa? What crisis in Syria? I don't know anything about any of that. I want to just come back here and sit on my well and pretend none of that even happens. Moses sits on the well, and you know what happens? Along comes some women. I mean, I don't know what more a guy could ask for. I'm way out here, I'm sitting in the well, and here come some women. All right. And they're having a little trouble, and he helps them out, and Dad loves the fact that he helped out the women, so, hey, you're welcome, come in, have dinner. Oh, by the way, you can have my daughter as your wife. And that's the way it happened in those days. And go be married and be happy. And for 40 years, we're told, he just, you know, that lives this life of relative contentment, not part of the privileged family of Pharaoh, but the part of the privileged family of one of the richest sheep herders, farmers in the land. So it's not a bad deal at all. And he doesn't have to worry about somebody going to kill him. And he doesn't have to sit and watch the hatred and the oppression going on all around him. A much nicer, calmer life. Is he going to be the Egyptian son or the Hebrew son? Well, he's picked the middle. I'm not going to be either. I'm just going to relax and enjoy what it seems God has put in front of me. Well, that's all well and good for Moses. And it's so much more comfortable when it is his story and his question and his decision about who he's going to be and which side he's going to take. It becomes a little less comfortable when we begin to suggest that, well, guess what, we are each in Moses' position. We are each offered the opportunity to side with the privilege and take great comfort in what the privileged have to offer, or to side with the oppressed and face their pain and suffering with them. And we're often faced with that middle ground opportunity. Let's just go somewhere and pretend it isn't happening, and just sit there and enjoy the peace and quiet of ignorance. Because it's one thing to participate in the oppression of another people, and it's another thing to just sit and watch it happen, and yet another to stand up and be counted in the opposition to the oppression. Life would be a whole lot calmer if the Gospels, if the Christian tradition, if perhaps God himself didn't occasionally call out and remind us that we are here to show compassion and care and to bring justice in the midst of great oppression. It'd be so much easier if we didn't have any responsibility toward our neighbor. So much calmer if we weren't people of God. The people of God, as scriptural evidence proposes, are the people who will stand up for the oppressed, who will stand up against the privileged, who will stand up and draw a line, who will stand up and put their lives on that line and their treasure for the sake of the oppressed. And so it's not enough to shake our heads now and then about, oh, it's just terrible what those people are doing. It's not enough to just say, oh, I wish there was something we could do to help those poor souls. We can't just sit on the well and put our head in our hands and say, oh, my, my. Eventually, we're going to hear the call. And no, it's not too likely it's going to be much at all like Moses' call. We're not not likely to be called out of nowhere to be the great leader of history. It's more difficult than that because we are called in each and every of our everyday decisions. Am I going to go buy myself a steak dinner? Or am I going to give to the hungry? Am I going to live in an all-white community so that I don't pretend that there's no racism going on around me? Or do I do something to stand up and reveal the racism that is at work, even in my decision to run an eye? Do I let my objection to bigotry be known, and do I do something to bring comfort and welcome and help to those who are being oppressed? Or everyday decisions in everything we do, how we spend our time, how we spend our money. In some ways it'd be easier, at least Moses had 40 years vacation time before he really got called to duty. We're called to make decisions. And sometimes we wish we weren't. And sometimes we pretend we are, but everything we do is a result of a decision we've made, a value we've established, a priority that we've set. Moses had to make decisions. His mother had to make decisions. Pharaoh's daughter had to make decisions. And they each chose life. They each chose justice. May God help us recognize the decisions we make that are helping to define which side of this struggle we're on. As individuals, as families, as congregation, what is our priority? How do we use our time and our resources? What is it that we're investing in? Justice or comfort? What is it we're doing with our lives, and what does it say about our decisions, about our identity? It's a lot more fun to watch the Ten Commandments and think that it's all some story of some ancient time, some bearded dude up on the hillside there. But when you realize that these stories ultimately are about us, let us pray. We are grateful, O God, for the ways in which your Spirit has led us in so many decisions in our lives. So very grateful for the decisions made by others in the past who have allowed us to discover your love and grace at work in our lives. So very grateful for generations and generations through centuries of people who have placed your priorities at the top of their own priority list. And we pray that you'll continue to teach us each as individuals, as families, to teach us all as congregation what decisions to make, which side to choose, how best we can truly serve you, how best we can express that love and compassion that is part of who we are. Continue, O God, to help us each understand how much you love us and how much you hope we can learn to love others. In Jesus' name.